Hey, everybody. I'm East Coast Pete, and that's Judy Sill. And what a story she's got. Judy Sill is actually spelled J-U-D-E-E. If you're looking her up, she was born in 1944. She died in 1979, an American singer-songwriter. She released two albums before dying from an overdose. There's a lot more to the story than that, folks. Stay here and buckle your seatbelts. When she was 35, the third album was not finished. She liked Johann Sebastian Bach, especially his suites. Her lyrics were about rapture and redemption. Born in Studio City, she grew up in Oakland. Her father imported exotic animals for Hollywood films. He also opened a bar in Oakland in which his daughter learned piano. When he died in 1952 of pneumonia, Sill's mom moved her family to LA and remarried to an animation artist who created the Tom and Jerry cartoons. Simon and Garfunkel fans, take note. Judy Sill described her home life after her mom's remarriage as unhappy and violent. Due to physical fights between her and her parents, she changed schools, hung out with rebellious teenagers, and was involved in crime. She met a man who took her on robberies of liquor stores and gas stations. Yeah, her. Sounds like an episode of Dragnet. The man was arrested and Judy was sent to reform school where she played organ at the church. She attended a junior college as an art major. Her mom died in 1964 and she moved out of her stepfather's home. She moved in with a drug pusher who specialized in distributing LSD. Sill joined a jazz trio at this time. In 1966, Judy Sill married pianist Bob Harris. The couple moved to Las Vegas and both became heroin addicts. Sill moved back to LA. She resorted to crime, including sex work, scams, and check forgery to support her addiction. She landed in jail. When her sentence was served, she set to work as a song composer. Enter Graham Nash and David Crosby. They took her on as a supporting act. They were a duo at this time. David Geffen signed her to his new Asylum album, and she sold her song Lady O to the Turtles, and she was featured on the cover of Rolling Stone magazine, and that is an omen. She worked on her first album, continued her acquaintance with the Turtles, and this led to a brief period as keyboardist for Frank Zappa and the Mothers of Invention. Graham Nash produced her single Jesus Was a Crossmaker, released in 1971. The album Judy Sill as well, Steve Stills added vocals. The album did not chart. Her second album, Heart Food, was out in 1973, critically acclaimed but poor sales. Asylum dropped her. Ow! She didn't like being an opening act. She also called Geffen a fat fag on stage. She didn't like his pink shoes. And that's not good for your resume. Excuse me one second.
See a little bit about that here. Okay, if you're gonna talk, probably not sing. Rather have her sing.
set Bastardom with a peculiar and beautiful back catalogue of songs that
faded
into obscurity before the end of the decade.
I know.
Here, the broadcaster.
How about that? Hopefully we'll get to hear her beautiful, beautiful voice. What a story, though, huh? All right. Anyhow, she continued to compose. She continued to abuse drugs, causing other health problems. She also found time to develop an interest in theosophy, an esoteric religion that had flourished in the last century. Her new songs never saw light until 2005, when Jim O'Rourke, an improv artist and record producer, mixed them and cobbled together an album which included home demos as Dreams Come True on the Water label. I believe this might be it. She could sing so beautifully. A lot of lightning and thunder going on in her head at the time, though. Syl might have been married 3 times. I say might have been because it's not definite. First, she was married to a high school classmate, but her parents had the marriage annulled. Her second marriage ended in divorce in 1972. She then married Samir Ben Taib Kamoun, a Tunisian actor, mime, and Charlie Chaplin impersonator. Syl was openly bisexual. J.D. Souther wrote Something in the Dark about Syl's. David Omer Bearden provided lyrics for Heart Food. There were serious car accidents, leaving her with a bad back. She was in severe pain when she died of acute cocaine and codeine intoxication. The LA coroner ruled it a suicide, but there was no suicide note, but there was a note found near her body. But like I said, this was not a suicide note. It was a song concept that she'd been working on. There was no obituary. Her family was long dead. For many years, a number of friends didn't even know that she had passed away. And there's probably a song in that. Andy Partridge, Liz Phair, Warren Zevon, and Sean all have been... Sean Cassidy, I think. I didn't write Cassidy, but I think that's who I'm talking about here. They've all been influenced by Judy Syl. Her songs were fraught with religious imagery, symbolism, and mysticism. There was a marked lack of sensuality and a philosophic denial of the physical. Her music has been described as intensely devotional. A supergroup named Case Lang and Veers from Portland composed a song about Judy Syl and included it on their 2016 album. I think you should really check that out. Again, that's Case Lang and Veers. Syl played guitar, organ, and backing vocals on Tom Peltier's Chariot of Astral Light album, recorded in the 70s, but not released until 2005. The songs were included on the posthumous Dreams Come True, a 2-CD set on Water Records. Her 2 other albums were released as CDs, also released called Abracadabra, The Asylum Years, a Live in London album of Sill's work, surfaced in 2007. The Hollies, Cass Elliott, Judy Suke, Warren Devon, and Rachel Yamagata have all covered Sill's songs. In 2009, the independent label American Dust released an album called Crayon Angel, a tribute to the music of Judy Sill, featuring covers by Beth Orton, Bill Callahan, Ron Sexsmith, Daniel Rawson, Final Fantasy, Marissa Nadler, Frida Hyvonen, and Meg Baird. The 1971 album Judy Sill had Crayon Angels, which is extraordinary, and two, The Phantom Cowboy. It's got unnecessary orchestration, sort of like what they did to Nick Drake's music. Three, The Archetypal Man, more of that damn orchestration. Four, The Lamb Ran Away with the Crown. And five, Lady O. Six, Jesus Was a Crossmaker. Oh my goodness, what a song. It's not like you think it is. Seven, Ridge Rider. Eight, My Man on Love. Nine, Loping Along Through the Cosmos. 10, Enchanted Sky Machine. And 11, Abracadabra. Here is Heart Food. 1, There's a Rugged Road. Yes, and no to the orchestra. Get rid of that orchestra. You don't need it, Judy. 2, The Kiss. Yes, and yes again. And no again to the orchestra. Get him out of here. 3, The Pearl. 4, Down Where the Valleys Are Low. 5, The Vigilante. 6, Soldier of the Heart. 7, The Phoenix. 8, When the Bridegroom Comes. 9, The Donor. And here are Dreams Come True. And then I'll shut up and we can listen. 1, That's the Spirit. 2, I'm Over. Yes, you are. 3, Apocalypse Express. 4, Living End. 5, Things Are Looking Up. 6, Good Ship Omega. I think that's got to be about the Alpha and Omega. 7, Last Resort. 8, Till Dreams Come True. 9, Living End. 10, I'm Over. 11, Till Dreams Come True. This is the instrumental demo. And then Dead Time Bummer Blues. Then The Sunny Side of Luck. Emerald River Dance. 4, Waterfall. 5, North Country. 6, Farmer's Daughter. 7, Wreck of the Fast Flying Vest. 500 Miles. And oh boy, The Magician. Oh boy is right. Thank you. Thanks everybody for being with me on Mid-Rock Crisis. If you can, find some Judy Sill and listen to it if you want to see what it was like in the 60s, because she's a really good example of a real person that lived at that time and went through that stuff. Everybody take good care. I'll be back.